presentation. And looking at the calendar, that's going to really compress our committee opportunities. So today is Thursday, the 16th. Normally we meet on 7 a.m. on Thursdays. We also have a Wednesday evening slot available for us. To get all of our work done, and members, we have about 20 more bills left before our committee. We're going to meet next Wednesday evening at 5 p.m. and take and docket all of those bills. The reason for that is because they've got to be out of full HBI by the following Tuesday, January the 29th, because the budget bill, whatever amendments come out of it, it will be will come out on Sunday, February the 3rd. So our meeting next week will be on Wednesday evening, January the 23rd at 5 p.m. We're going to docket all the bills. So for the folks in the audience and the stakeholders and so forth, you got to have that work done by next Wednesday, because we do not have an opportunity to take it by for the day. You're going to have to besiege the Uber chair to my right. And he's a very loving and compassionate and caring gentleman. But yeah. But there is a process, I's and A's, but there is a process by which we need to stand by. First, one house cleaning, Delegate Kilgore has asked that his House Bill 1970 still has some moving parts and they don't have it completely ready for prime time, so I'll accept the entertain a motion to take that by. I've moved to second without objection, and by general consensus, House Bill 1970, if you came here to speak to that bill, is by for today and will be taken up next Wednesday at 5 p.m. We have a hard stop time today of 8:20, which is about an hour and 18 minutes from now, so that the full HWI can efficiently and appropriately take its time and do its work in due time. So we're going to try to press on and get these bills taken care of this year. So first on the order, Delegate Jones. Delegate Jones, I draw the committee's attention to House Bill 1871. Good morning, sir. Tell us why we need your bill and what your bill does, please, sir.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the subcommittee. House Bill 1871 is a recommendation from the Commission on Youth. It seeks to amend the Code of Virginia, Section 63.2-611C.1. And this would provide transitional child care for TANF recipients who are participating in an education or training program that leads to employment. I'll give you a brief explanation of why this is a good idea, why we support this on the commission. The Code of Virginia allows TANF funds to pay for child care services for working parents currently who are who can need child care assistance while transitioning off of TANF benefits. The code does not allow for child care subsidies for families transitioning off of TANF who are participating in approved education and training programs. So there's a little bit of a gap that we're seeking to fill. This would allow unspent TANF dollars in Virginia to be spent on these child care services for low-income families who are transitioning off of TANF while the parents complete these approved education training programs. So I think I will not try to trespass any time. If you guys have any questions, I'd be happy to entertain
them. Members have any questions for the patron? Is there any amendment? Yes, sir. Delegate Lorca.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, Delegate Jones, I do have a question. I see no requirement of a minimum number of hours that an individual will have to be enrolled as a student. So this would create a circumstance whereby if they were taking even one class
online,
and even just online, which would take them many, many years to ever complete a degree program, that they would still be eligible to receive these funds during that period so long as they remain enrolled in one class. And I also don't see anything that speaks to the fact that they have to be successful in that class.
Mr. Chairman, Delegate Orr, I would say that typically, it's our commission's understanding that these programs, these transitional programs, take about 6 to 12 weeks, and that's our expectation to transition off of TANF before they become fully independent. I also have some folks from the Commission on Youth here who might also be able to speak to some of the questions that you guys have.
So I'm sorry, I just wanted to clarify. So you're saying that it's about the length of the transitional period, not the length of the educational program.
I believe that's what we're talking about here. I think, and Amy is here with me, if you look at line 38 of the bill, where we're talking about 38 and 39, it says, and is taking courses as part of the curriculum that leads to a post-secondary credential, such as a degree or an industry-recognized credential, certification, or license. I think that's what we're trying to get at, but I do understand Delaware's concern
passed. Anyone in the audience to speak in favor of House Bill 871? Yes, sir, if you would come forward, please identify yourself, please, sir. And bless it, please, brief.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. My name is Salam Bhakti, public benefits attorney at the Virginia Poverty Law Center. Briefly, we support this bill. I think it's something we all agree upon. We have some ways working to better themselves and have a better life for their families. Not only if they're working, but also trying to get a higher education. I think we should support this bill. Thank you.
All right, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Anyone else in favor? Anyone in the audience to speak in opposition to House Bill 1871? All right, if not, the measure was blessed with the committee. And I would remind the committee, this does have a fiscal impact. We deal with TANF funds upstairs. TANF is about block granted at $158 million federal and about $123 million state every year, so it's about $281 million or so. We keep a corpus in that for downtimes, so that if there's emergent needs for or urgent needs for temporary assistance to needy families in those economic downtimes and business cycles, we are prepared as a commonwealth for that. So typically what we do upstairs in Health and Human Resources is consider all of the TANF requests and try to look at that sort of in its totality of it. Sickles is very familiar with this process, serving on the HHR subcommittee as well.
In light of that, I would move the report and refer to it.
Second.
All right. Members know it. Probably moved and seconded that House Bill 1871 be reported from our subcommittee and re-referred to appropriations. Members, if you vote on the electronic voting record, please. Measure to report to report and refer is passes on a 10-0 vote. Sir, you do not. I'm sorry. 10-0 vote. Sir, you do not need to be at the full committee to report, delegate. Thank you very
much. Thank you, Mr.
Chair. Yes, sir. All right. Next is delegate for the members of the full HWI. You're going to be here at 8:30 anyway, so I'm gonna let the other delegates that probably got other committees and stuff want to go forward. So delegate Stolle, delegate Rodman.
I have to come to bill at 7:30 upstairs.
Well, okay. Well, why don't you go ahead and then jump forward now, sir, because you're actually second on the queue because your staff signed you in at 2:06 yesterday afternoon.
So he wants to do this in full committee?
I'm going to try to get the three delegates that are actually here that are not members of HWI first. So I fully expect we're going to be done with this, sir, by 8:30 today. So don't go far.
Gotta go far.
Okay, then don't go far right now. Delegate Hope.
Dr. Chairman.
I draw the committee's attention to House Bill 1812, 1812.
I have an amendment with Sarah.
These are two amendments. Whoever drafted put the wrong names for the wrong names for the waiver, so we're just doing technical amendments to update that. The amendments are on line 13. We're going to go ahead and strike intellectual disability, so that would be an insert community living. And then farther down that line, strike individual and family development, developmental disabilities, and insert family and individual. So those will be the appropriate updated names of the waivers.
And that's just a technical consideration, so. Without objection, by general consensus, House Bill 1812 is thusly adopted or amended. All right, Delegate, please tell us why we need your bill and what the bill does.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. What the bill simply does is it says that if you are on the DD waiver waiting list, and you are a foreign service officer and you have to travel or your job to go overseas, that if you intend to come back, that you can still remain on that waiting list. This issue was brought to us, it was at our public hearing, came to us from the Arkansas, Virginia. I know Delegate Sickles is nodding because this was brought up at their public hearing as well. This is happening in at least, I know two examples, several examples in Arlington and several examples in Fairfax where this has occurred, and I just want to make it clear in the Section 1 bill that the policy is that if you are foreign service and you're on the list, tend to come back, you can remain, keep your spot on that list when you return.
Mr. Chairman, I believe somebody testified to this at our Appropriations Committee on the Northern Virginia hearing on the Thursday before we came down here as well.
Right.
And this is a critical bill for people who want to have a career in
Chairman.
Is anyone from DMAS here? If you could just explain how this would work and how y'all would know to hold the slot.
So my name's Ann Nevin with Department of Medical Assistance Services. As you know, there's a waiting list at statewide. There are three categories for prioritization. This just simply allows the Foreign Service member who retains legal rights of residency to stay, or the child dependent, to stay on the waiting list. It doesn't have any effect to what's going on already.
How would y'all know to keep them on the list?
Each year, the CSMs do an annual review to make sure that they're very clear about the individual's needs and that they want to be retained on the waiting list, so they make multiple contacts to the family just to ensure they do want to remain on the waiting list. If they do not, then they're removed and given appeal rights.
Should we put language in here to the effect that it will be the responsibility of the family to notify the CSV on the front end, if you understand what I'm saying? If I'm getting an assignment out and I want to maintain the slot for my child, should there not be some responsibility on me as the one, you know, to let y'all know, hey, I'm signing this for 6 months, it might be 18, you know, but I want to hold the slot for my child so that they don't have to keep chasing me around wherever I've gone.
It's an operational issue. I don't know if it necessarily needs to be in the language. It's on both parties.
And before you say, right now we grant some sort of different status for active military. If you are deployed overseas, then you're willing to put your life at risk, then and you have a dependent and they are on the waiting list, they don't drop off that waiting list once they reach to the top simply because you happen to not be physically domiciled in Virginia at the time. Is that correct?
Correct. They do not drop from the waiting list and their prioritization does not change. It is about the individual, not necessarily the family. Remember, there's three categories.
Right. So we're getting ready to now prioritize diplomats and foreign service people that simply because they may be going overseas for 2 or 3 years, the fact that they have to be in foreign service over other people that may be going overseas, missionaries, public, college and university professors that may go overseas for a year or two, we're going to now prioritize them above any other Virginian that now be deployed overseas, if you will, and serves in a public service.
And if that happens, then they'll go to the proper priority and stay on their waiting list.
All right, members have any other questions? Is there anyone in the audience to speak in favor of House Bill 1812? Anyone in the audience to speak in opposition to House Bill 1812? All right, the measure rests with the committee. The probably moved in second of the House Bill 1812 report. My only consternation, though, and hope is I don't understand. I don't know how many Foreign Service members have dependents that would be now prioritized, maybe 2 or 3 folks that we're talking about, maybe hundreds of folks, but I have a lot of folks in my district that are on the waiting list. We hear every year we've got to, get all the priority ones funded. We've got 13,000 folks, and I just don't know how I can go back. I suspect I don't have a lot of these folks in my district, so I may not have to explain it to a lot of folks. I'm going to have to explain it to all the other folks that are not employees. So that's my only concern.
If I could clarify, Mr. Chairman, this not means that they're prioritized. It means they stay on the list. So anyone who's in need that is in that priority one list will remain in that list. If they're a priority one, this does not change that status. This just keeps you on that list, not the priority one.
All right, and I thought you were saying that if they had then risen to the top of the priority, and because I'm no longer domiciled in Virginia because I'm now deployed overseas, you maintain your position on that list. All right, well, that's the prioritization. All right, it's been moved and seconded that House Bill 1812 be reported. Members, vote on your electronic voting record. The measure to report passes on a 7-3 vote, and you'll be at full committee anyway. So.
Yes, sir.
All right, so thank you very much, Doug. All right, next on our list is Scott. Draw the committee's attention to House Bill 1971, sir.
1971 is correct.
If you would please, sir, tell us why we need the bill and what the bill does.
that gets suspended in one state, that gets suspended in 30 states, and it's a constant circular suspension for these folks. So what this does is it puts some language in the bill that says, if we suspended you and you corrected that suspension and another state suspends you because of the original suspension, we're not going to suspend you again.
That's a lot clearer than what I understood. So thank you very much for that clarity, sir, because I think I was circuitously the different. Members have any questions? So Dr. Delegate, and I presume in today's day and time with a lot of locum tenens, a lot of physicians and other healthcare providers that are working in lots of different areas and telemedicine, I suspect this is probably something that would be of benefit, I surmise.
Absolutely, and I was just approached about one physician that had 30 licenses, and when you're suspended, often you have to actually hire a lawyer in each of those states to take and get that license back. Additionally, it's reports to the National Practitioner Data Bank for each suspension. And so this essentially just snowballs and snowballs. But you're correct, as we see more and more mobility among the physicians and other licensed health professionals, this gets to be an increasing problem.
All right, sir, thank you very much. Is there anyone in the audience to speak in favor of House Bill 1971? Yes, sir.
Morning. Morning, Mr. Chairman. Scott Johnson from the Medical Society of Virginia. We wholeheartedly support this bill.
All right, sir. Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Dr. Barbara Allison Bryan, the Chief Deputy of the Department of Health Professions. There is a part two to this bill, with all respect.
I'm sorry. Sneaking in on line 63 is a strike from 30 to 60. This is the Board of Pharmacy aligning them with what the other departments are doing.
Thank you for that clarity. Sometimes these delegates just won't tell us all.
Thank you.
Sneaky little things that are in their bills. I say that simply. All right, anyone else in favor of 1971? Anyone in the audience to speak in opposition of House Bill 1971? All right, any further questions? It's been probably moved and seconded that House Bill 1971 be reported. Members vote on the electronic voting record. Members report passes on a 10 to 0 vote. All right, Delegate, you have now House Bill 2026.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. House Bill 2026 directs support of health to a cytomegalia screening, to newborn screening for those who have failed their newborn screening hearing test. Congenital cytomegalia virus is a common cause of infant illness and hearing loss, and other significant neurodevelopmental problems. Identification early on can improve outcomes, both neurologic, developmental, and hearing. Mr. Chairman, although I did not see one yet, it is my understanding that there will be a fiscal impact statement associated with this bill. I have a budget amendment in to take and support the bill, and I'm happy to answer any questions on the screen.
All right, so members have any questions? Delegate Bell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Douglas Tyler, is this after one fail on the hearing screening test, if they failed just one time? And I'll tell you why I asked. I understand that some newborns can fail for various reasons on that first screening, be retested, and be fine, especially a C-section baby.
Mr. Chairman, Dr. Bell, that's correct. It would be after the fail. You're also correct that there are a number of reasons that baby can take and fail that initial screening test. They can just be very upset and screaming a lot and not pass that test. The test for cytomegalovirus virus is either saliva or urine on the baby, and it would just identify whether that baby has been exposed to cytomegalovirus or is actually infected with cytomegalovirus. So the screen would be failing that initial test. That is correct.
Thanks.
All right, further questions? Anyone in the audience to speak in favor of House Bill 2026? In the audience to speak in opposition to House Bill 2026? address that, but health actually sits on health and human resources subcommittee of appropriations, so I'm sure it'd be well heard. The proper and seconded that House Bill 2026 be reported from our subcommittee and referred to appropriations. Members, you'll vote for under electronic voting. The measure to report and refer passes on a 10-0 vote. Delegate Sally, thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All right, Delegate Bulova, you are next with House Bill 1743. All members' attention, 1743. Good morning, sir. If you would tell us why we need your bill and what your bill does, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. House Bill 1743 is a recommendation of the Joint Commission on Healthcare, which I have the pleasure of serving with you on, Mr. Chairman. And what it does is it encourages pharmacists to counsel their patients on the importance of proper drug disposal. And so, as you know, the existing code requires pharmacists to offer counseling to patients who are presenting a new prescription, and proper drug storage is one of the suggested items on that list of items to be counseled. And what this bill does is simply add proper disposal to that list. The issue came up during a much larger study from the Joint Healthcare Commission with regard to drug take-back programs, which was brought to us by Senator Vogel. The study revealed a couple of interesting statistics, and I guess the biggest takeaway is that the two-thirds of medicines aren't used, and 53% of those are ultimately stored at home. So that really does open up the opportunity for misuse by family members, inappropriate reuse by the individual without a new prescription, as well as accessibility to children. I guess there are about 60,000 emergency room visits each year for children who ingest these prescriptions nationally. There's also an environmental consequence. So as these things are flushed down the toilets inappropriately, we have about 80% of the streams in the United States actually test positive for pharmaceuticals. So while there are a lot of options that were debated, the one that everybody was able to agree on, I think this is the only one that came out on this particular topic, was to make sure that in addition to storage, that disposal options were also something that a pharmacist could talk to their patients about. So Mr. Chairman, it's permissive. That's the bill. I appreciate your consideration.
All right, sir, thank you very much. Members have any questions? Delegate.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, not on this bill specific, but is there someone from Board of Pharmacy or representing them? Thank God. I completely agree with the premise behind this bill. I would just ask, my concern speaks to the existing language as it relates to how a pharmacist may offer quote-unquote counseling. And he will have satisfied, he or she will have satisfied constraints of the law if there's just a sign, if there's a notation on the bag. And I guess for a minute, have there ever been any discussions that we need to be a little bit more proactive in how we offer counseling? Because it's great to say that they're going to offer these things, you know, and counsel patients. But I can tell you, when I go and get my drugs, you know, the young lady that said, well, any questions? You don't know what you don't know, and so I don't know to ask.
Right.
And so I never see the pharmacist unless it's a new script, and then they proactively say, this new one, any questions? No, I don't know what they don't know.
I think that goes both ways. I think one of the benefits of this bill is that it is permissive. I think that all of us are aware of the problem of storing and disposing, especially of opioid medications, and that most pharmacists are doing this anyway. I think most, and I go at Delegate Hodge as I say this, I think most pharmacists are doing this anyway. And I think our biggest push now is going to get more drug take back sites in at the point of sale. That's going to be even more powerful.
Good bill for next year. Delegate Bell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Delegate Bova, premise bill. My question is, does this restrict that council to just the pharmacists or can the counsel in the same way?
That is a great question, and perhaps that's something that
I don't know the answer.
I can answer that. Pharmacists are the only ones that can counsel the patient.
Line 36.
Yeah, actually, the line 36 says, actually, it even in the code says pharmacist himself. So, quite specific to that point. All right, further questions for the patron? Anyone in the audience to speak in favor of House Bill 1743? Anyone in the audience to speak in opposition to House Bill 1743? All right. Measure S with the committee.
Move to report.
They probably moved and seconded that House Bill 1743 be reported. There may be folks that just say, you know, right now, there's nothing that prohibits pharmacists from giving any information. All eight of these things that are delineated in the code have maze before a medical. You don't even have to, I guess technically, you don't even have to check the name and prescription of the medicine. You don't even have to check whether it has any side effects. Most people, as a practical matter, though, most pharmacists do that. And they do it because it's not just good business practice, it's good people practice. So I'm okay, but I could see how this might not necessarily be as important. All right. It's been probably moved to second that House Bill 1743 be reported. Members will vote on their electronic voting record. The measure to report passes on a 10-0 vote. You do not need to be a full committee on the poll.
Thank you very much.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. All right. The next is Belly Camp. Draw the committee's attention to House Bill 1952. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman.
If you would tell us why we need your bill, is what your bill does, please.
I sure will. Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, this bill was brought to me at the Medical Society of Virginia.
Do we have an amendment to this? To
we have a substitute.
A substitute, okay. Now, Cam, if you would just tell us what the substitute does, and we'll put it as proper.
I think the essence of the substitute simply was to impose a blatant act of clause for the right. Opportunity to promulgate regulations.
All right, so the substitute is every, all members have had a chance to review this. That'll get a lot.
Mr. Chairman, I've seen you've added a new couple of definitions as well, collaboration and consultation. I guess my question, I'm not sure I have heartburn, but under the single purpose rule, all the original measure was doing was adding podiatrists, patient care team podiatrists. And now we're adding a couple new definitions. If you could explain how that's remaining relevant to the initial legislation of single purpose.
Mr. Chairman, I'll let Mr. Johnson explain.
Chairman, members of the committee, if you look on line 356 through 366, those definitions are in existing law, and they were moved over to the page that Chairman Omarock referred to because of that section, because it's the definition section.
Thank you, sir. All right. Without objection, by general consensus, the substitute House Bill 1952 is properly before us. Belly, please again tell us why we need your bill and what your bill does now, sir, as it's substitute.
Well, as I was saying earlier, obviously, question why it is exactly that Scott asked me to carry the bill. I think as it turns out, it's because I was a member of this committee. And then, as further evidence that no good deed ever goes unpunished, I was promptly removed from the committee. So, and here I am at 7 a.m. with this morning bill in front. And I don't represent to you that the bill had anything at all to do with my removal. I think that was because Elder Robinson is horrible qualified to not excel in this committee.
Duly noted, sir.
But in any event, here we are. And what the bill basically does is it transitions supervision of physician's assistants to a team-based model analogous to what you currently have with nurse practitioners. What is important to note is it doesn't give independent practice authority in any way to physician's assistants. Again, Medical Society worked for a couple of years on this measure with the stakeholders, and I do believe there's peace and harmony in the valley in that regard.
And Delegate, correct me if I'm wrong, I just want to make sure I didn't misunderstand you. I think what it does is it puts physician's assistants in the posture that nurse practitioners used to be in prior to Dr. Robinson's bill last year, which granted them independent practice authority.
Correct.
It changes the structure in which physicians and their assistants that are typically employees of those physicians now would be in these patient care teams and in a model like that, which grants arguably a little bit more independence to the physician's assistants, grants them to be able to extend their knowledge. skill sets and take care of our folks in a patient care team model, which is a little different than what the nurse practitioners today have. But it's, it was a precursor to the current status for nurse practitioners. Correct. Is that pretty accurate? That's correct. All right. All right, members have any questions of the patron? Anyone in the audience to speak in favor of House Bill 1952 as it is substituted? Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, the Medical Society has worked for almost 2 years with the physician assistants on this. We support this. We think it will help with access to care. I'll give you an example. If I'm deploying a new clinic or office somewhere and the operations council looks at the current law and they're making a decision about who can I send there, under the current law, it's being interpreted that if I'm going in a rural area, an underserved area, I have to put a PA and a doctor, as opposed to maybe a nurse practitioner. Now you're given more options. And this is not an independent practice bill, it's a team care bill. We ask for your support.
All right, sir, thank you for the clarity. Yes, ma'am.
Good morning, Rose Rutherford. I am a practicing PA in the current presidency. We support this. We'd like to get a panel for carrying this bill.
All right, thank you very much. Yes, ma'am.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the HWI of the Virginia Hospital and Healthcare Association, and we support the bill.
All right. Anyone else in support? Anyone in opposition to House Bill 1952? Not measure S committee. Committee, everybody understands what we're doing? Change them a little bit. Okay. Committee works by a motion. Or like that. But probably moved and seconded that House Bill 1952 as substituted be report. Members will vote on electronic voting record. The measure to report passes on an 8-0 vote. So, Delta Cameron, you do not need to come back to the committee in which you perform your members. Thank you, sir. All right, next is, let's see, Delegate Aird. Draw the committee's attention to House Bill 2005. Good morning, Delegate.
Good morning.
And if you would please tell us why we need your bill and what your bill does.
Sure. Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, again, good morning. Before you is House Bill 2005. This bill comes as at the recommendation of the Virginia Department of Social Services. House Bill 2005 will bring the Code of Virginia in line with federal regulations and allow children to retain eligibility for TANF up to the age of 19 if in secondary school or an equivalent technical program on a full-time basis, regardless of the graduation date. Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, right now we have children and families across the Commonwealth losing vital TANF support while these children are still in school due to a legal technicality of the date of their birthday. Currently, if a child turns 18 before his or her graduation from high school, the student and the family loses access to TANF despite them still being in school. Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, bringing our code in line with federal practice is just one of the ways this body can help our young people triumph over poverty. And in closing, the governor's introduced budget provides funding for this legislation. I hope the committee can move the bill forward.
Okay, that was very well presented. Mm-hmm. Just saying. Just saying. All right, members have any questions about it? She can present all my bills, I'd be better. You have questions about it? No.
So then you got our price?
Yes, sir. All right. Is anyone in the audience to speak in favor of House Bill 2005? Yes, sir. Come forward.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. Salam Bundy, Public Benefits Attorney at the Virginia Poverty Law Center. It's a very practical bill. You can be in high school for multiple reasons and still be 19 years old. We hope that the committee votes for this. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much, sir. Yes, ma'am.
Chairman, members of the committee, Becky Bowers, we're here on behalf of the Virginia Association of Community Services Boards, and we support.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Chair,
all right. Just anyone in the audience to speak in opposition to House Bill 2005? All right, not the member of the committee.
Move to report to the chairman.
And should this bill be properly positively received by our committee, we do have a letter that requires it to be referred. The request is that it be referred to appropriations, again, to be taken up in consideration, as I said earlier, Delegate, with this bundling of all of the TANF requests that we have. We have a lot more requests than we have TANF resources available for. All right, it's been properly moved and seconded that House Bill 2005 be reported and referred to appropriations. The members will vote on electronic voting. policy element to refer to rebuild to appropriations, report and refer to appropriations passed on a 9-0 vote. Thank you, Delegate. Delegate Carrier, you've been very patient. We appreciate your patience. Draw the committee's attention to House Bill 1914. Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning, Mr. Chair.
Please tell us why we need your bill and what your bill does.
I can start with the why. Is that we want to prevent the spread of diseases that actually could result in the mortality. Right now, we need to just give you a quick summary. The bill authorizes the local health department practitioners to provide post-exposure prophylactics to expose individuals for conditions that would pose an imminent risk of death, life-threatening illness, or serious disability. Current Virginia laws allows the prescription of PEP when such treatment is necessary. In order to prescribe PEP, though, however, we must have a bona fide practitioner-patient relationship, including an appropriate physical examination. In the majority of cases, clinicians for either patient or exposed contact will prescribe PEP either directly or indirectly as allowed by the law. However, in instances where there is no clinician willing or able to prescribe PEP, as might occur when individuals are uninsured or underinsured, or when the window of time for administering the prophylaxis is very small, a local health department practitioner is often called upon to provide treatment. This poses a barrier to trying timely treatment in instances when the health department clinician is not routinely available at a site to develop a bona fide relationship with the patient. The bill provides an exception for the physical examination requirement to allow for the provision of post-exposure treatment when there is an urgent need. The bill does not change any of the current requirements to obtain medical or drug history, perform the appropriate patient counseling regarding the benefits or risks of the drug prescribed, and to initiate additional interventions and follow-ups. Mr. Chair and members, the bill also amends language that was passed last year to allow the expedited partner therapy for those physicians that are under contract with the Department of Health.
All right, and Delegate Harry, I just want to make sure I didn't misunderstand what you just said. You said that it doesn't change the requirement to have the conversation about the risks and benefits of the drug. That conversation today with expedited partner therapy is only held between the practitioner and the incident individual. That conversation is not necessarily held with all of the other consorts because the incident individual is actually now distributing that medications to the handful or however many other individuals that are now involved in that interaction. Is that correct?
Let me take a step back. So the bill does two things.
You got a phone friend behind you.
All right.
I think your question, Delegate Garrett, is specific to PPT, is that correct?
But that would now translate to this as well.
It's actually in a different paragraph, if I'm understanding correctly. On the meat of the bill is in paragraph E, starting on line 99. The introduced language is on line 108. So that's not specific to expedited partner therapy. The language pertinent to expedited partner therapy is back earlier in the bill, in paragraph towards the end of paragraph B, which is around.
All right, got it. Well, let me ask you this question. If today the physician-patient relationship requires me as a physician to have an informed conversation with you about the risks and benefits of my therapies or just in this particular case, drugs.
That's right.
If with expedited partner therapy or with post-exposure prophylactic therapy that you now wish to do, mm-hmm. if the whole issue that I have with the doctor is we are now abrogating that responsibility. We are putting that responsibility with the incident individual to now have that conversation with whomever else that individual is going to get those antibiotics or antivirals to.
The clinician still has to meet the three of the four criteria of the bona fide practitioner-patient relationship.
With the incident individual, not with all the others.
And with the contact.
Is that currently the case with PPP?
it's practically, it's worked out that way, yes.